Hello and welcome to the 81st session in the AISafety.com reading group. Tonight we will be discussing part of an article called Reply to Bostrom's Argument for a Hard Takeoff by Brian Tomasik. Brian Tomasik is a co-founder of the Foundational Research Institute based in Berlin. He has a popular blog called Reduced Suffering, and he has a less wrong profile, so his arguments about AI safety are likely to be intelligent. The article in particular is called Artificial Intelligence and Its Implications for Future Suffering. And we are only reading two chapters, roughly 10% of this article, the one called Intelligence Explosion and Reply to Bostrom's Arguments for a Hard Takeoff. Note that the first half is written before Bostrom published his book Superintelligence, Paths, Dangers, Strategies, meaning that some of it can be a bit dated, so I will go reasonably quickly through that. We'll start with Bostrom's conclusion. What does he believe about the about a hard takeoff? Bostrom believes that a fast or medium takeoff is more likely, a slow takeoff is possible, and there might be no takeoff at all. I've tried to draw it like this: 10% chance of no takeoff, 20% chance of a slow takeoff, 30% of a medium takeoff, and 40% chance of a fast takeoff. Bostrom explicitly does not commit to a conclusion like this, so this is just my interpretation for being able to compare with what does Brian Tomasik mean. So what does Brian mean? He believes there will be a some kind of takeoff. He says that's nearly inevitable. Of course, this is all assuming that we don't get killed by a giant meteor. All these kind of predictions always assume that we don't get killed by anything nasty, aliens or whatever. He also believes that there will be a 70% probability of a slow takeoff. So I've tried to draw this in roughly the same way. 2% chance of no takeoff, and 70% for a slow takeoff, 8% for a fast takeoff, and 8% for a medium, and 20% for a fast takeoff. This is maybe not, of course, this is also not endorsed by Brian Tomasik. So this is only for illustration of what is the difference in opinions. And you might wonder why so much on fast takeoff. Well, when I interpret his arguments, many of them are not so much about counter-arguments to a fast takeoff, but often that a slow takeoff will not suddenly turn into a medium takeoff. So for this reason, I've written that he probably has low credence to a medium takeoff. I don't actually know that. It should also be noted that, if Bostrom puts 40% chance of a fast takeoff and Brian 20%, then there's a lot of things that they agree on. And I've explicitly chosen in this presentation to only focus on the parts that they disagree on. This is the classical example from Bostrom's book Superintelligence of how a takeoff will look. There's a time until takeoff from where we are now, a particular takeoff, and then after a strong superintelligence has been created, some kind of physical limits to the capability of the strong superintelligence. And of course the focus is on the takeoff, this area of the graph. And how is that going to look, in particular, how long from here to here? How long will the takeoff be? One minor nitpick here is that Brian Tomasik many times refers to this as exponential, that there will be exponential growth, whereas Bostrom refers to this as hyperbolic growth. And the exact shape, whether it's a good idea to relate it to these kind of elementary functions, is a good question, but it doesn't appear that. I think there's a chance that Brian Tomasik might be a bit confused about Bostrom's interpretation of this part of the graph. So, intelligence explosion. The first part, Brian Tomasik have a number of arguments. The first is that it is certainly possible that the problems become much harder at some point, that the challenge of improving an intelligence might become unsuspectedly harder for some for different reasons. It is, of course, possible that it will be like this, but most of the optimization problems that we see have this kind of exponential growth, where economies grow with 2% and optimization processors go twice as fast every 18 months, this kind of thing, which is what Bostrom calls constant recalcitrance. So obviously it is possible that Brian Tomasik is right, but it seems there's a good chance that the problems will not suddenly become much harder, at least without a good reason. Then there's the argument that right now we have a good, strong, positive example of general intelligence, namely humans and the human brain. And because we have this, we should expect that AI design should be progressing much faster now than it will do later. It is, of course, possible to emulate the brain and do something, build an artificial intelligence that works in the same way as the brain. Unfortunately, there are a number of technical problems with this. Emulating a brain requires figuring out how the brain looks and then running it in a computer, and both of these tasks are really, really difficult from a technical point of view. We'll eventually get there, I'm sure, but right now the AI we're trying to make is very different from just emulating a brain. In the second part, which I'll focus on, Brian Tomasik presents 6 arguments for a fast takeoff by Nick Bostrom and answers each of these 6 in turn. The first argument is that there might be a key missing algorithmic insight, which allows for dramatic progress. This is a fair characteristic of one of Bostrom's arguments. And Brian Tomasik notes that there are no precedents in artificial intelligence. There haven't been something that allowed for dramatic progress. I would point out something like the backpropagation algorithm. Brian Tomasik says that this have at most given a 50% or reduction in running time, a twice speed up, and I'm quite sure that is incorrect, that the backpropagation algorithm has actually been a rather dramatic progress. And of course, we haven't seen any truly dramatic insights, because we expect that a truly dramatic insight in artificial general intelligence might kill us. So it's called the anthropic bias or survivor bias, that we haven't seen anything that has killed us yet. Brian Tomasik has a long paragraph citing the internet as an example of something that has been created by a missing algorithmic insight. And he attacks this kind of as I would call it a straw man, unfortunately. I don't think Bostrom or anyone else has said that the internet is an algorithmic insight in any kind of way. So attacking that is kind of a straw man, I'm afraid. He discusses nuclear weapons as an example of an algorithmic insight. He says that might, however, be an outlier. It's true that it's an outlier. Outliers might be the only thing that is really interesting in this case. But I'm kind of stuck thinking that nuclear weapons is also a bad example of algorithmic insights. Then he discusses Bostrom's example of an AI with 2 subsystems, one that is general and one that is narrow. And he claims this is patently absurd because there is no way that the performance of these subsystems would not be visible to the researchers. I think time has shown now that people working with artificial intelligence often don't really have a strong insight into the internals of their algorithms. So it is certainly not absurd. Again, from the description Brian Tomasik gives of this example, it's not clear that he completely understands this example, unfortunately. So, if those are bad examples, can I do better? Well, I have tried actually to come up with an interesting parallel for algorithmic insights. So this is something that is not in the paper, but something that I have tried to get closer to the subject. So if we want to have an intelligence explosion is going to happen, then algorithmic insights that immediately improve the performance is something that is going to have a big effect. The way humans get algorithmic insights right now is basically by thinking for a long time. To be a bit more precise, they're using their brain and updating the biologic general neural network in their brains and using that to obtain algorithmic insights. What we are interested in is how it would look if it was an artificial general neural network or some other AGI algorithm that provided these algorithmic insights. Note that we're not just talking about general algorithmic insights, but algorithmic insights for how to think faster, how to update the neural network in a better way. Unfortunately, it's really difficult to say what algorithmic insights are possible for an algorithm that we do not have. So my suggestion or way to look into this is comparing with matrix multiplication. Matrix multiplication is a way you can use that to update a neural network, this algorithm. It's slow, but the algorithmic insights have already been made. So we can imagine a parallel world where the problem of AGI boils down to doing matrix multiplication in order to obtain a better algorithm for doing matrix multiplication. This is actually not that far-fetched. The algorithm for matrix multiplication depend in a crucial way on matrix multiplication. Matrix multiplication is a way from two of these mathematical objects to obtain a new mathematical object. Here we have two 4x4 matrices that are multiplied to give a new matrix. The naive way to do this is an algorithm that takes have a running time that is calculated by the number of rows to the third, meaning that if there are four rows here, you can calculate this new matrix in 64 operations. So the up here, there's a graph with the exponent for doing matrix multiplication. It starts out at 3, and in the 50s and 60s, it was not obvious at all that there was a faster way to do this at all. But around 1970, Strassen invented a way that brought this exponent down to 2.8, made it substantially faster. Another decade passed, and then Coppersmith had a new idea for how to improve this algorithm, a new algorithmic insight, bringing the exponent down to 2.5, and another insight where these two people, Coppersmith and Winograd, was thinking for a decade and then came up with a new, better algorithm. And after this, there were more work done, not bringing the exponent down, but making it parallelizable using MapReduce and other algorithms. So we can see, it seems like there is one breakthrough every decade, where you can see the exponents going down roughly in this order that I just showed. So if we go back to this example where we are assuming that the way to get these insights for how to do matrix multiplication actually comes from doing matrix multiplication, what would this kind of world look like? Well, if it takes one decade, then one decade, that's roughly 2 to 28 seconds. And a computer like mine, 4 gigahertz, can do 2 to 30 second instructions per second. Meaning that my computer can probably do 2 to the 16th instructions per decade. And with an exponent of 3, that means that in the naive case, my computer would take a decade to multiply two matrices that are 2 to the 20th in size. So if we say this is what is required for a algorithmic breakthrough, then let's try. We start in 1960 and we start working, and after a decade we get the first breakthrough, and that takes one decade. But then we can do matrix multiplication faster. Now it only is 20 times 2.8, that is 2 to the 56th, or 16 times faster. After we've learned how to think faster, we can now do the same work 16 times faster, or only in 228 days. after we do these 228 days, we obtain a new algorithm that has an exponent that is even better. Now we can do it 1,000 times faster than we could before, or in 3.5 days. So the next breakthrough comes much faster. And then the second breakthrough happens in less than 1 day. And then what took humanity a full decade to understand how to parallelize this will then happen in less than a day, and then parallelization will enable this to go even faster. So the breakthroughs, instead of coming one per decade, they will suddenly accelerate to an extreme extent. And I would expect now this kind of matrix multiplication could be done in less than a second. And of course, having major breakthroughs coming every second makes for a world that is very, very unrecognizable from ours. This is an example of a foom. If in a parallel world where matrix multiplication is how to get algorithmic insights for matrix multiplications. So that was a detour. I was very happy with this argument. So that's why I presented it here. And now I'll return to the other five arguments Brian Tomasik has. The first is the second argument is about the content overhang. That an AI might at some point pass a threshold where it can access a breadth of information such as reading the internet. And Brian Tomasik says that compares this to the world's current superintelligence, humanity as a whole, which is a parallel I must say I kind of disagree with, because humanity isn't a single intelligence in any meaningful way. But Brian Tomasik posits the following claim that he believes in, but without any strong evidence, at least in this part that we're reading. No crucial set of components to general intelligence exists that all need to be in place before the whole thing works. And given this is the case, something like reading will likely not be an all or nothing activity, but something where reading comprehension slowly becomes possible. This is of course possible. I would point out, for me, I distinctly remember going to school one day, not being able to read, and then suddenly I figured it out, and then I could read. For me, learning how to read happened very much in all or nothing way. It does to some people, and for other people it's a more gradual way. But to me, it suddenly clicked. The second argument is that if we have gradual improvements to the algorithms in artificial intelligence, then most likely there will be no content overhang. And this argument structure, that gradual improvements will block these kind of multipliers for the takeoff, is a key part of Brian Tomasik's argument. So we'll see that many times. The second issue is the hardware overhang. That hardware, more hardware might become possible through funding or hacking or this kind of thing once we get to a human level intelligence. Brian Tomasik argues that artificial intelligence as a field could get 10 to 50 times more funding, and that's of course a lot. I would perhaps object that the funding for the field might matter a lot less than funding for the project that obtains human level intelligence. But the point stands. But again, Brian Tomasik points out that if we have a gradual increase in capability, then this hardware overhang will not happen, and because there will be a gradual increase in funding. Then something I have called it an attention overhang, meaning that researchers working on this might work harder and there will be more researchers recruited. Again, if we're in the case where the improvements are happening very gradually, then I'm sure the research attention will also come more gradually, and there'll be no overhang where things will suddenly start to move really, really fast. He also has another point that I really liked, that the number of people working on AI safety will multiply if there is a Sputnik moment where suddenly people realize that AGI might be close. So this means that the ratio of AI safety work to total AI work might not change, even if the physical timescales compress. I think this is a really good point. I haven't seen it before. So I like that a lot. There are, of course, some disadvantages to starting late, but it's surely better than nothing. This is also something that Eliezer Yudkowsky has argued against in his No Fire Alarm for AI Safety article. The last two arguments are about recursive self-improvement. Some of the things I have tried to show in my example with the matrix multiplication, that the AI self-improvement might dominate that of the human engineers, leading to exponential growth, as Brian Tomasik says in, those are the words Brian Tomasik put in Bostrom's mouth. And I think Bostrom is thinking more about hyperbolic growth than exponential growth here. Brian Tomasik talks about precedence here, and this is, of course, depending on what you see as reasonable previous cases to compare with. But there's a point, again, if there is a gradual improvement, then the intermediate step will be diffused in some way, meaning that recursive self-improvement will not be a major factor if the takeoff is happening slowly enough. And I agree with it, but it's not really a strong counter-argument to Bostrom's argument. Then there's an A-side about the Manhattan Project, where Brian Tomasik says that the Manhattan Project, which is given as an example of something requiring great insights, required 100,000 scientists. His citation is broken. I've went to Wikipedia to see how many people actually worked on the Manhattan Project. And a lot of the people working on it were not in any meaningful way scientists here. Perhaps only 1,000 people knew that work on atoms was involved. Then there's a final argument about how much the people in the world compared to the people in the project, which matters the most, giving the example of Watson, the AI, that it required 60 man years, but tools that cost billions of man, maybe not man years, as I wrote here, depending on how you calculate all the things that were required. And Brian Tomasik asks, how many people would be required to achieve a radical leap in intelligence? Doesn't really answer this question and might not really be considered a counter-argument. But in total, I think that his arguments are strong. And I think they, as I hinted in the beginning, it's possible to see this as arguing against a moderate takeoff. Because the classical way to think about a takeoff is that there are several factors like the missing algorithmic insights, the hardware overhang, content overhang, attention overhang, all adding up in some kind of way. And this will bring even a slow, even if two or three of these don't pan out, then if just one, we'll move from a slow takeoff to a medium speed takeoff. Brian Tomasik points out that it's more likely to be if we get an algorithmic insight, then we will more likely have hardware overhang, which will lead to content overhang, which will lead to some kind of attention overhang. And this process will go faster and faster and faster. But it requires some kind of algorithmic insight. And algorithmic insights are really important. And I think this is a very important contribution. And in general, I like Brian Tomasik's article quite a lot. Thank you for watching, and see you again next time.